Hello, so this will be a continuation of my initial lecture, which was where I talked about the WHO classification, the newer WHO classification, and the various markers and genetic codes that we have to take into account when we are talking about tumors. Most of that lecture is geared towards how to manage a patient. So that lecture was geared towards people who actually treat patients. This is geared towards people who are entirely in a freestanding diagnostic institutions, not so much as a neuro-oncology or cancer center where they're actually directly involved in treatment of patients. So this is something that every neuroradiologist should be able to recognize, and generally radiologist should have a ballpark of what I'll be talking in the next two sections, where I'll be going along each specific cell line of a tumor, and I'll be taking a few examples and talking about how they are presenting, what is the most classic picture of that on imaging, and what would be the things that we are supposed to tell the clinician when we see that. One of the things that we should be very careful of is the mass effect. See, all tumors have masses. They are masses, so they have mass effect. That is one of the hallmarks. When you see an abnormal signal or on an MR, an abnormal attenuation on a CT, whether there is volume loss or mass effect. If there is volume loss, it's an old injury, it's gliosis, not something we have to be worried about. When you see a mass, it can be anything causing mass effect, but tumors will also be causing mass effect. Mass effect is something that we have to be specially paying more attention to it, because this is what immediately kills the patient, not the tumor. The tumor can be treated if we have time with it, but mass effect is something that can overnight kill the patient, especially when tumors are present in posterior fossa. And this is not just for tumors. This is for infections. This is for an abscess. This is for hematomas, trauma, subdural collections, subepidural collections, anything. If you see something causing mass effect or herniation, that is something that can kill a patient very, very quickly. And you have to be immediately calling the clinician, not letting the patient go home, and immediately taking care of the patient. He should not leave the hospital in that situation. So that is something that is, when we are talking about tumors, every radiologist and neuroradiologist, this is something that they should pay special attention to. So going on a step-by-step basis, one of the few things that I want you to remember from this lecture is, do not be obsessed with trying to come up with a histological diagnosis. Almost a majority of the time, we find out the exact histologies, even between, say, WHO 1 through WHO 2 and 2 to 3, we find out the correct diagnosis after the biopsy, because the tumor may look overall like something, and then is actually the most aggressive cell line is a different set of tumor, or the genetic cell line is of a different type, like I had mentioned in the first lecture. It is the genetic code which trumps the histological appearance. So the correct diagnosis will be maybe completely different of what we are thinking of. To be in the correct ballpark is acceptable. What we have to do as a physician, as a radiologist, our job is not to let a patient who can die or with the aggressive tumor to go home without treatment, and not make sure that a patient who has a benign lesion, something what in bones we call as do not touch lesion, something like that in brain, if he has something which is not a very aggressive lesion, make sure that the surgeon doesn't get to operate on that, because surgeon's job is to operate. They will operate on anything. Our job is to make sure that an unnecessary patient does not go to a surgery. The most important, as I mentioned in the first slide, the most important point that you have to know is that all masses have mass effect, and this is what kills the patient quickly, and this is what we have to be careful of. That is one point. The other point is, if you see a lesion and it does not have mass effect, chances are it is not likely a neoplasm. It is not likely a very aggressive lesion. It is more likely a gliosis or some old pathology which is giving artifactual appearance of a neoplasm. So just remember that. This is the other thing that I again talked about, that tumors may not be what we see them on imaging. They might turn out to be something completely different because they are histologically named after the most aggressive cell line. And also, even if they have a completely different histology, if the genotype is different, then they will be named after the genotype cell line. How do we classify tumors? Luckily, we do not have TNM classification, but we still have to be talking about what the location, what kind of cell line it is, what kind of histology it is. To some extent, we cannot tell the histological diagnosis, but we can tell to some extent of where exactly what kind of cell it may be arising of. So we divide it according to the location, where it can be intraaxial or arising from the parenchyma, or it can be extraaxial, and that includes the ventricular system. Something like a colloid cyst or say an intraventricular meningioma would still come into an extraaxial lesion. It would not, a colloid cyst would not be an intraaxial lesion. Then it may be arising from a bone directly, like a metastatic lesion or lesion or a bone pathology that is extending and pushing the brain parenchyma and is intraaxial in location, something like that. And dural is the another location which it can be from the extraaxial. And most of the time it is going to be meningioma, but dural based metastasis, dural based collections, something like in leukemia, CLL, you can have collections over there, which would be tumors, and they are essentially confined within the dura. So those would be the other extraaxial pathologies. Then this is by location. Once you come into the intraaxial locations, we tend to give a kind of a diagnosis which would be along the cell lines. So it may arise from astrocytes, so you'll call it a glial tumor, or they can arise from pituitary cells. So you will give according to what it may be arising from, like a neuroendocrine or a pharyngeal tissue. So pharyngeal tissue would be include macroadenoma, microadenoma, Rathke-Klebs cyst, craniopharyngiomas, those kind. That would be what you would be talking about. If they might arise from ependymal cell line, with ependymoma being more so into projecting into the ventricular system, subependymoma more so along the parenchymal lining. Although keep in mind that subependymoma has a better prognosis than ependymoma. Then they may arise from nerve cells such as schwannoma, neurofibroma, or they may arise from choroid plexus cells. They can be both malignant and benign, and accordingly they are termed as papilloma or papillary carcinoma. Then they may be arising from primitive cells like teratoma, dermoid, epidermoid, germinoma. Those would be the things that you would think of if they're arising from cells. And then it may be arising from arachnoid cells or lymphoid cells or pineal gland cells, or they may be metastatic in nature, or they may be arising from meningeal cells. Now keep in mind that the arachnoid cap cells or the meningeal cells do not necessarily have to be entirely located within the dural lining. They can be associated in the ventricular lining, they can be in the PL lining. So all those lesions arising from those can still be meningiomas. We have to keep that in mind. So that would be the description for all the tumors arising in the brain parenchyma, and then you tend to give them some sort of diagnosis from what possibly the underlying pathology may be. Then coming out into extraaxial location, we talked about if it may be ventricular, a tumor would be a colloid cyst. You can have neurocystic sarcosis or other parasitic infections, or you can have lesions arising from the dural lining, which may be meningioma or maybe dural bed metastasis, or they may be arising from bone, from the skull base. You would have something like a chordoma, chondrosarcoma, plasmacytoma, or from any other portion of the calvarium, you can have metastatic disease. So once we see a tumor, the first thing we have to tell what the location it is. We talked about intraaxial and extraaxial. So how do you tell that? So all intraaxial tumors, there is no continuity with the bone. There are very rarely any bone changes. I have seen in my entire 15 years of practice, one GBM, which is extending directly into the bone. Otherwise, they're all confined within the brain without any associated bone changes. They cause effacement of CSF spaces. There is no corticomedullary buckling, which is seen in extraaxial tumors like meningioma, where you also have a CSF cleft which is present, and gray-white distinction is obliterated or involved in intraaxial tumor, and vascular supply is generally from internal carotid artery. When we see a tumor, so now we have decided that it is an intraaxial tumor. Now when we see a tumor, what do we talk of? We have to tell how big is the tumor, what is the extent of the tumor, how many lobes it is involving, whether it is involving the gray matter, white matter area. Then we have to talk about, when we talk about the tumor, we have to tell what is the actual viable tumor, because a lot of time a lot of tumor present with cyst and a solid nodule. In most of the things, the solid nodule is the real tumor. The cystic portion is just something which is with the tumor, and when they go in surgically, they resect the solid nodule, the cyst involutes most of the time on its own. So we have to tell the enhancing component in an aggressive neoplasm, that is the viable tumor. If the periphery of the cyst is enhancing, then the cyst is also part of the tumor. So you have to tell about that. That also comes into the viable tumor. And if possible, I know the surgeons don't tend to like it, but what are the possible treatment options that you can mention? Because if there's a tumor, say you're talking about a pituitary lesion, and it is coming too close or is almost abutting the optic pathways, then gamma knife radiation therapy from the get-go is not something an option. You have to debulk so that there is greater than 2 millimeter gap between the optic pathways, because otherwise if you heat up the tumor by gamma knife, if you burn the tumor, then that direct heat can be conveyed into the optic pathways and it can cause blindness. So that is something you have to mention, some sort of treatment options or things that are not to be done to that patient. Then lastly, I talked about what kills the patient. This is what is the emergency, is the mass effect. If the patient is herniating, if the lesion is in posterior fossa, the patient can rapidly degenerate and deteriorate. This is something that you have to mention. Then how do the tumors spread? They can have direct extension, so they'll spread along the axons, the perivascular space, and if there is a surgery or a biopsy, they can spread along that. So that would be a direct contiguous spread of the tumor. Then you have what is called as a distant spread. Now again, keep in mind, brain tumors rarely ever metastasize. There are some tumors like a choroid plexus papillary carcinoma or a medulloblastoma, ependymoma. Those kind of tumors do metastasize, but they stay confined to the neural axis, and they can go down along the spinal cord or superiorly on the supratentorial region, and they metastasize along the PL or the leptomeningeal linings, and that is called as the drop metastasis. Then you can have metastasis along the transepidermal lining. This is seen frequently in GBMs, where you see one GBM completely disrupting the ependymal lining, and then completely opposite side on the brain or a distant area, you see another enhancing lesion. So one, it can be a multifocal GBM, which is certainly a possibility, or it can be a transepidermal spread of a tumor. And then it can extend, say, if a tumor extends up to the PL lining, it can spread along the PL lining and then have another focus or a deposit distant from the original one, and that is the spread of the tumor. Edema. So tumors cause vasogenic edema. You have to differentiate between vasogenic edema and cytotoxic edema. Cytotoxic edema is something that is like an active edema where a sodium potassium pump defect is responsible for it, where there is ischemia, infection, toxic metabolic conditions. Whereas in abrupt insult to a brain, it is generally vasogenic edema, such as a trauma, tumor, hemorrhage. And here, in this case, the mechanism is defect in the blood-brain barrier. The edema tends to be extracellular. It responds very well to steroid treatment, and cortex is generally spared in the edema. So these are the things that overall in intraaxial tumors that you are supposed to mention, that where it is arising, how much it has spread, what are the things it is involving, and the mass effect, the most important being the mass effect. Now let's go along the cell lines. Let's start with the glial tumors or astrocytic tumors. And this is, again, we talked about all the genetic markers. We may see, we may feel it to be a certain type of glial tumor. It may come back as a completely different tumor based on its genotype. So keep that in mind. We don't have to be 100% sure. We have to tell them that there is a tumor, it is causing mass effect, these are the locations, these are the possible approaches that can be used. That is our job in neuroradiology. Now, we talked about the WHO classification. This is more so geared according to how, if I look at a tumor, what do I call it? Now, grade one, exactly by a WHO classification, where they go into those four criteria of gliomas, that it doesn't have any of those criteria, it's all fine. It's what the true way should be. But when you're looking at a case and you see a certain kind of tumor, there are certain imaging characteristics that we use to decide that what is grade one, what is grade two. And I'm going to be talking about more so focused according to a clinical approach or sitting on a reading room approach as to how I, or in our institution, how we go about talking about tumors. We had talked about that they're classified according to grade one through grade four. So according to me, when I see a tumor which is solid, no necrosis, no enhancement, very minimal peritumoral edema, very minimal, or rather a very narrow zone of transition, we call it a grade one tumor, and that being the low-grade astrocytoma, and other ones being ganglioglioma, gangliocytoma, dendrocytoma, neuroectodermal tumor. Those kind of tumors are generally very, very low-grade tumors. So what we'll see is a non-enhancing tumor with a narrow zone of transition, not associated with enhancement. Very frequently, the three I talked to you about, ganglioglioma, gangliocytoma, and low-grade astrocytoma, involve the mesial temporal lobe. When we see an abnormal signal intensity in the mesial temporal lobe, it can be either a tumor or it can be mesial temporal sclerosis. So mesial temporal sclerosis will have loss of volume. It will have prominent CSF spaces. It will have a dilated temporal horn. So those are the things that you will look for in mesial temporal sclerosis. Here it will be exactly the opposite. It will be mass effect. There will be compression of the temporal horn. There'll be obliteration of the CSF spaces. Overall, it will look like a very bulky appearance as we are looking over here. This was a low-grade astrocytoma. All these may still present with seizure, epilepsy, but again, we have to differentiate between a tumor and mesial temporal sclerosis. Now, some of these tumors, like a gangliocytoma, can have small cystic areas, may have a faint enhancement, but by far, these are non-enhancing low-grade tumors confined to the location. They can be anywhere in the brain. These three tend to be along the mesial temporal lobe, as opposed to immediately lateral to it. In the lateral aspect of the temporal lower temporal parietal region is the dysembryoplastic neurotectoral tumor. This is again a low-grade neoplasm. It is something which grows very slowly, in fact involves both the cortex and the white matter, can have a bubbly appearance. It is completely non-enhancing, generally low attenuation on CT and low signal intensity on T1, bright on T2 signal, and no enhancement associated with it. Very, very infrequently do they cause any significant mass effect. Will have a very narrow zone of transition where the subjacent brain will be completely normal. They may present with seizures or headache, or maybe incidentally detected. So these, again, grade 1 tumors, when I look at it, it is going to be a focal lesion with surrounding brain being completely narrow, with very little mass effect, low T1, bright T2, low attenuation on CT, absolutely enhancement associated with it. So this condition, Lerner-Midlethor disease, is kind of a funny thing. It is classified as a tumor. It is also sometimes called as a benign condition, but it tends to grow. Progressively, it can tend to grow, and the significance of that is it is in the posterior fossa where there is not much space. So it can compress the front ventricle, cause hydrocephalus. It can herniate, and that can suddenly decompensate the patient and kill the patient. Even the hydrocephalus can suddenly decompensate and kill the patient. The classic appearance would be those prominent folia that you see along the cerebellar lining. They are maintained, they are thickly packed over there, and they cause distortion of the one side of the cerebellum, and they compress the fourth ventricle or the aqueduct of Salvius and are associated with restricted diffusion. So this dysplastic gangliocytoma can also have a bubbly kind of appearance. Again, most important thing is it will be associated with very little enhancement, if any. The cerebellar folia will be maintained, and it will be kind of involving one side of the cerebellar hemisphere. There is no associated necrosis, there is no significant mass effect. Again, it is confined to a location. There is the subjacent brain parenchyma tends to appear completely normal. So it will be a very narrow zone of transition, and abruptly the rest of the brain will be completely normal. So we talked about grade 1 neoplasm. Now, what makes grade 1 to grade 2 on imaging? On grade 1 to grade 2 on imaging is basically we start seeing enhancement in that tumor. Otherwise, the tumor will be exactly the same. It will be low T1, bright T2, no associated necrosis, no hemorrhage associated with it. But we start seeing enhancement with it, and there might be some peritumoral abnormality. Intensity. So this would be a grade 2 neoplasm. We don't see any necrosis associated with it. There is no associated hematoma associated with it. There is no significant mass effect. In this case, there is no peritumoral edema. There's a very narrow zone of transition, but there is enhancement associated with it on the post-contrast, even on the right. So this would come under grade 2 tumor by imaging. This is another one, oligodendroglioma. Some of people tend to consider this to be a very benign tumor, but oligodendroglioma has a wide range. It can look like a very, very benign tumor confined into the frontal lobe, low attenuation, narrow zone of transition. Yet at the other extreme, there are 3 to 5% which shows necrosis and intense enhancement and appear very, very aggressive. Where when you look at it, you call it a grade 3 neoplasm, but it turns out to be having calcification. And once you see calcification, that tumor is going to be an oligodendroglioma unless proven as something else. By far, if you see a calcification in a tumor, you will consider oligodendroglioma as your primary diagnosis. So these tend to be having a less well circumscribed than the grade 1 neoplasm, tend to have some peritumoral abnormal signal. They're kind of infiltrative. They're not kind of like a clear margin, and they're associated with calcifications. This is a case of another case of oligodendroglioma where the first case is in the right frontal, the second in the right parietal, left case is the left frontal lobe, where you have loss of gray-white distinction, you have a mass over there, low T1, high T2 signal intensity. This may or may not have enhancement associated with it, but will definitely have calcification, which will be the hallmark of an oligodendroglioma. Now, not all oligodendrogliomas have calcification. About like 30 to 50% of the oligodendrogliomas tend to have calcification. But once you see calcification, it is going to be unless proven otherwise oligodendroglioma. This is another example of an atypical oligodendroglioma where I was talking about where they can look as very, very aggressive. So the second and the third cases, which we have in the middle and on the right, you have intense enhancement associated with it. Now, this can anybody can easily confuse that this is a very poor zone of transition on the second and the third case. It has intense enhancement, significant mass effect. This can be an anaplastic astrocytoma, and nobody will be wrong in giving this out as grade 3, but this turned out to be like an oligodendroglioma. Now, I had talked to you about the cystic and solid neoplasm. One of them in a childhood is the pilocytic astrocytoma, which present as a cyst and a solid nodule in an adult patient. This is the entity, pleomorphic xanthoastrocytoma, that gives an identical appearance. You will have cyst and a mural nodule, again, in which you have the cyst portion, which does not have peripheral enhancement. That is not the tumor component. The tumor component is the solid enhancing nodule, which is present. If there is enhancement along the periphery, then you should consider that the cyst also as being a viable tumor, and that might be central necrosis, or that is a cystic component of a neoplasm. So look for enhancement carefully along the margin. That is what decides. So if you see a cyst and a solid nodule in an adult patient, in that these tend to be located in the temporal or inferior frontal lobe, the primary diagnosis should be pleomorphic astrocytoma. Now, what makes grade 2 into grade 3? We talked about the cystic lesion, but that is not a pilocytic astrocytoma. A pleomorphic xanthoastrocytoma is not a grade 3 neoplasm. The cyst is not a tumor. To make it into a grade 3 neoplasm, you should start having central necrosis. So you will have enhancement. You will lose the narrow zone of transition. You will have significant peritumoral changes. You will have significant mass effect. But the hallmark that we use to convert it into a grade 3 neoplasm, necrosis associated with it. So this is an example of that, where you have the second and third slides, which showing a low attenuation mass lesion, and on contrast administration, there is peripheral enhancement. So if you see, there is enhancement along the margin of the central necrosis. So this is not just a cyst which is associated with the neoplasm, but it is actually the necrosis present in the tumor and the periphery is also a viable neoplasm. So this is what we use in WHO3 class. Classification, that you will have a central necrosis present in the neoplasm, you'll have a wide range of transition, you will have significant peritumoral edema, you may or may not have significant associated with it. This is another case of a type 3 tumor where you have central areas of necrosis, you have peripheral enhancement, you have a wide zone of transition, significant peritumoral edema, significant mass effect, and T2 hyperintensity, flare hyperintensity, low T1 signal associated with it. But you should not have hemorrhage when you're calling the WHO3 calcification. So you will have necrosis, you will have enhancement, which is a step up from grade 2 neoplasm because you're getting necrosis, but you should have hemorrhage. Once you start getting hemorrhage in a tumor, we tend to start calling it grade 4 neoplasm. So everything that the grade 3 has, central necrosis, rep, or significant enhancement, wide zone of transition, edema, abnormal signal, peritumoral signal abnormality, but with the presence of hemorrhage, we will call it grade 4 neoplasm. So, or GBM or gliomatosis cerebri. Now, gliomatosis cerebri is unusual in the fact that it may or may not have enhancement associated with it. It may or may not have necrosis or hemorrhage associated with it, but it is still a grade 4 neoplasm. In fact, it is one of the most aggressive neoplasm, rapidly spreading along the entire cerebral hemisphere, involving more than one lobe, sometimes the entire cerebral hemisphere, with significant mass effect, and very, very difficult to treat. Now, this one was a GBM. Now, we can see necrosis and associated hemorrhage in it. So, this was a pre-contrast on the right, pre-contrast CT. So, there is a mass lesion, but in the mass lesion, there is hemorrhage. Now, when you see it for the first time, you don't straight away call it a GBM. You have to rule out other conditions like vasculopathy, amyloid angiopathy, trauma, or venous sinus thrombosis, cortical vein thrombosis as the causes of hemorrhage. Once you have ruled that out, and after you do an MR, you wait for the tamponade effect to go away, and then you do an MR with post-contrast imaging, and you see enhancement and all those things, then you call it a tumor. You don't just jump to that you see bleed and this is grade 4 neoplasm. We have to rule out all the other conditions. On the right, again, you see a centrally necrotic, peripherally enhancing with central area of hematoma along the dorsal posterior aspect. This was another case of GBM. Now look at the peritumoral edema, significant peritumoral edema, significant abnormal attenuation, has a distant enhancement, has compression on the ventricle causing herniation. Now that is what can kill the patient quickly. The GBM, you still have time to treat it, but the herniation, and you can also see the left lateral ventricle is getting dilated, so it is being trapped. So these are the things that are emergencies. This patient should not go home. You should hold the patient at your institution, or he should go directly to the ER, and the surgeon should be aware of this because this patient can rapidly decompensate and die. Now, the classic thing about GBM is it crosses midline. Whenever they are close to the corpus callosum, they catch the white matter fibers and immediately cross over to the other side. There are other conditions that can cross the midline, but this, when you see a centrally necrotic peripherally enhancing neoplasm, this is what you would think of. It would be GBM. No other tumor tends to cross the midline. So these are multiple different cases of a GBM. Central necrosis, crossing the midline, peripheral enhancement, significant peritumoral edema, significant mass effect. So even if in this case you don't see a hemorrhage in it, but it is crossing the midline, then it is still a grade 4 GBM. It is not going to be grade 3 or grade 2 neoplasm. Only GBMs can cross the midline. These are the things that actually cross the midline. So all these will remain in the differential. In a tumor, it is going to be GBM and lymphoma. Then other things that you can do that are demyelinating disease, metastasis, and infection, all those things. So if you see a centrally necrotic peripherally enhancing mass, and you are thinking of neoplasm, it is going to be between metastasis and GBM. Lymphomas tend to be solid with restricted diffusion and with intense enhancement in sheets. That would be a classic case. Lymphoma, they tend to hub the ventricular lining and they can definitely cross over the midline along the corpus callosum. But these are solid tumors. They generally don't have central necrosis, as would be seen with the GBM. The demyelinating disease would be enhancing with restricted diffusion, but focal areas, not with bulky mass effect associated with it. So these are the things that you have to keep whenever you see a lesion along the callosum crossing the midline. This is what we had talked about initially when I was talking about the GBM, that this is an aggressive form, gliomatosis cerebri. It is a grade 4 neoplasm. We may or may not see hemorrhage every time, but this is a tumor that spreads along, sometimes along the entire cerebral hemisphere. Sometimes it even crosses the midline and goes to the other cerebral hemisphere, and there will be wide zone of transition, low attenuation on CT, T2 flare signal abnormality. In fact, you would think that there is almost the entire brain is abnormal. And if it would be a child, you would think of something like migrational abnormalities and those kind of things, that what is going on with the brain. But you may or may not see enhancement in it. And once you see multifocal areas of these, then it is going to be, your diagnosis should be gliomatosis cerebri. This is another case of gliomatosis cerebri. You can, on the first case, you can see that almost the entire right cerebral hemisphere and portions of the left frontal lobe are involved. It is crossing both along the anterior commissure. It is crossing along the corpus callosum, splenium of the corpus callosum in the first case. So this is, again, something like a tumor. It is not having necrosis. There is no clear hemorrhage. This would be still grade 4 gliomatosis cerebri. The same thing in the second case, where you have multiple areas of T2 hyperintensity. You have lost your gray distinction with mass effect and cortical swelling. This tends to grow along the cortical lining, and this would be another case of gliomatosis cerebri. In a third case, you have multiple areas of enhancement separately in the right sylvian fissure than in the right periatrial region. Now this would have a differential of either multifocal gliomatosis cerebri, or it would have a differential of glioblastoma multiforme or gliomatosis cerebri. Since there are so many areas involved, there's mass effect, but there are different locations, so that would be the difference in this condition. Now, one of the things that you have to differentiate when you see a centrally necrotic peripherally enhancing lesion would be from an abscess as well as a hematoma. All three will give you similar changes, where you'll have a central area of non-enhancement, which is a necrosis, and then peripheral area of enhancement. Now, hematoma, as it is involuting later on, not replaced by hemosiderin yet, you will have the identical appearance. But neoplasms tend to have slightly thicker wall, and they would not have central areas of restricted diffusion, which will be classically seen in an abscess. One of the things that you have to keep in mind is those micro hematomas, small hematomas, or hemorrhagic metastasis. metastasis may potentially have associated restricted diffusion. So that even more confounds the differential as to whether it is going to be septic emboli or is it like a metastasis or is it a hematoma or what is it? So, but that is something that you have to keep in mind, that a small hemorrhagic metastasis can have associated restricted diffusion. So this was the first case is a case of an abscess where this central area of restricted diffusion. The second case, there is no restricted diffusion. This was a case of grade 4 neoplasm glioblastoma multiforme. So these are the things we talk about, that how do we go from grade 1 to grade 4. So grade 1 would be a solid non-enhancing tumor. Grade 2, you add minimal amount of enhancement without necrosis. In grade 3, you add necrosis to it, and on grade 4, you add hemorrhage into the necrosis. So that would be overall summary of what how we classify gliotumors. So that would be the initial presentation of the tumor. Now we have to talk, once we start treating the tumors, once you have treated the tumor, how do we follow up gliotumor? So it all depends upon non-enhancing versus enhancing, or WHO1 versus WHO2, 3, and 4. What do we look for? So if it was WHO1, the initial tumor was not enhancing, so you can't rely on perfusion imaging or post contrast imaging for recurrent tumor. What you're looking for, your money images are the T2 images, where T2, it looks like more like a slightly darker soft tissue, which is new, which is within the area of treatment, or T2 hyperintensity, which is generally representing gliosis. So look for that. Look on the, that would be one thing. On the other thing would be ADC. ADC would have, it would be dark, recurrent tumor would be dark on ADC. Contrast imaging is not a reliable thing. So you have to see subsequent studies. And sometimes what happens is you keep seeing the, comparing it to the immediately prior comparison, and you say unchanged, unchanged, unchanged. But if you go back, say, 4 or 5 studies about maybe like 8 or 9 months ago, and you will see like a significant change in that appearance. So that is another thing that you have to keep in mind, that just looking at immediately prior examination, sometimes you cannot perceive the change that is present. So always when you have like 8 or 9 prior studies, make sure that you compare it to the immediately prior one, as well as go back maybe like 6 or 7 studies and compare it to that, so see that they're imperceptible to eye. There has been a change since then, which if you compare to the old examination, we can see. So those are the things that you see in a non-enhancing tumor. In the enhancing tumor, which was like 2, 3, or 4 type WHO, it becomes relatively easy. What you're looking for is just a new area of enhancement, distant enhancement or within the same area, but a new. All you have to do is differentiate between radiation necrosis versus recurrence, and that you can easily do by CBV perfusion study, or you can do by a PET scan. Again, all these threshold for this is about 6 to 8 millimeters of a new lesion for it to be perceived on CBV. Smaller than that, it is difficult. But then what you, so when you see, is if you feel that there's a new punctate area of enhancement, you can't identify it on CBV. So what you do is a shorter term your follow-up examination, like a 1 month follow-up examination, until either it involutes or it gets bigger where you start suspecting it recurrent neoplasm. So this is what we see with for recurrent neoplasm. How do we follow up these studies? So WHO1, there was no initial enhancement. So your baseline exam would be post-surgery to make sure that it's complete removal. After that, you do a 1, 3, 6 month follow-up, and then 12-month follow-up, and then yearly follow-up for 5 years. And if it is negative for 5 years, then you consider it to be treated. Now, most of the institutions just throw in a CBV because it is difficult to tailor each order exam. So all these patients still come up with perfusion imaging, but ideally, perfusion imaging really does not help in any way or form. In fact, even post-contrast imaging really does not help in any way or form, unless the tumor has a more aggressive degeneration. Then you see a sudden, you see a low-grade neoplasm with a new enhancement. That means the patient has degenerated into a grade 2, grade 3, grade 4 neoplasm. It is not remaining a grade 1 neoplasm. But perfusion imaging really does not help in subsequent follow-up. WHO1 classification. On the other hand, on a W enhancing lesion, whether it is 2, 3, 4, what you have to do is always give post contrast, always do a perfusion imaging, because that is what you're looking for. Most of these are treated with radiation also, so you want to differentiate between radiation necrosis versus recurrent neoplasm and a new area of enhancement. So when you operate a patient who has enhancement, and within 6 to 8 hours, granulation tissue sets in and it matures around 12 to 24 hours. So if possible, if it is doable, then your first follow-up examination should be less than 6 hours immediately post-surgery, if you can do it, to look for any residual enhancement that would identify residual tumor. In fact, at our institution, a lot of tumors, a lot of these patients get intraoperative examination. So they'll resect portion of the tumor, they will do an MR examination, and then they will see for any residual enhancement, they'll go after that, and then again they will do. So he's getting an MR inside the OR while they are taking out the tissue. So that way you can be sure that, because the granulation tissue has not set in, within 12 hours the granulation tissue that is there, and if there was a residual tumor, then it gets confusing. Sometimes you can compare it to the pre-op exam and you see enhancement exactly in that location. So this is not granulation tissue, this is residual tumor. But if you can do it within 6 hours before the granulation tissue sets in, that would be ideal. Otherwise, you do it after 12 to 24 hours when the granulation tissue has matured. Then subsequently, the follow-up is the same as with grade 1 neoplasm, that you do it 1, 3, 6, 12 month follow-up and then yearly follow-up, unless you see a new enhancement, then you closely, you decrease the follow-up interval. And this is entirely decided by the clinical services, that if we see a punctuary of new enhancement, say at 6 months, then they will, the next subsequent follow-up may be at 7 months instead of 12 months. They won't wait for entire 6 months for a subsequent follow-up because they saw a new enhancement and they're worried that it will be recurrent neoplasm. Now, these are a few post-treatment scenarios that I will be talking about. This was a low-grade neoplasm, and this is what I was talking about. So if you look at it, 1 year apart, there was no T2 hyperintensity along the margin. Now there is a new area of T2 hyperintensity, which is present along the dorsal medial aspect of the surgical cavity. So this is what we are looking for in a WHO grade 1 neoplasm. This is a recurrent neoplasm. This is a high-grade neoplasm. This was baseline immediately post-surgery. Subsequent examination, if you see, there was some enhancement which was taken as, oh, this could be post-treatment. So we did not treat the patient immediately. He returned after from 1 month to 3 months. He returned and that enhancement has significantly grown. So this is what you're looking for, a recurrent tumor in a high-grade WHO 2-3-4 neoplasm, that new enhancement, new mass effect, new peritumoral edema. Then this is big enough where you will probably see a vision imaging also. Now, this is a case of radiation necrosis. We see a treated area where there is central necrosis and peripheral enhancement and T2 hyperintensity. Now, this can very well be recurrent neoplasm. It can very well be a GBM or anaplastic astrocytoma. But how you differentiate it is by PET scan or cerebral blood volume perfusion examination. This was a CBV where you see it is completely cold. There is no increased uptake over here. There is no new vascularity. So this is going to be radiation necrosis and recurrent neoplasm. And we have to keep one thing in mind, that radiation necrosis in its initial stages can actually grow. There might be associated mass effect, and over a period of time it finally involutes. So this was a case where initial study showed 6 months apart showed there was central necrosis, peripheral enhancement, which is taken as radiation necrosis. That enhancement and central necrosis actually started crossing the midline, was associated with minimal peritumoral signal abnormality, but not that much mass effect. So even, and the CBV was negative, so it was still taken as radiation necrosis, and follow-up examination showed involution of that. This is radiation necrosis in post-gamma knife. So this is what happens if you see it over a period of time. You should not image gamma knife treated lesion in less than 1 month, because in the initial stages, if the second row was done 2 weeks after the initial treatment, so it looks as if the tumor has grown. And if you are not aware of what is happening, you may actually go and try to treat it more. So this is post-treatment hemorrhage and enhancement associated with it. It looks as if the lesion has significantly increased, but as the time went, it involuted, it decreased in size, and eventually the enhancement had completely resolved. So this is the time period between radiation therapy and when you follow-up examination is important, because in the very, very initial stages, it looks as if the overall tumor has worsened and increased size. This is how we did, like I showed you separately on two separate slides, recurrent tumor versus radiation necrosis. This is on the same slide for comparison. In the first row, we have a enhancing lesion with peritumoral edema, which was intense elevation on CBV perfusion study. So this is going to be a recurrent tumor, as opposed to on the opposite side in the second row, where you have a similar area of enhancement and then necrosis with again peritumoral signal abnormality, but that is completely cold on perfusion sequence. So this is what a radiation tumor necrosis looks like post examination. This is the effect of Avastin when you start using for suppression of the VGEF and new vascularity. So there was a centrally necrotic peripherally enhancing lesion and you started using Avastin. The first study showed the tumor and the signal and the enhancement to involute. But on subsequent studies at a later stage, if you can see on the ADC, there's darkness on the third in bottom slide. So that means despite the medication, the tumor is continuing to grow, and although the lesion itself appears to be somewhat unchanged, in fact even involuted from the initial study, the tumor actually is rapidly progressing in the underlying area. So this is the major problem that we encounter with Avastin, that there is pseudo response, that the tumor is actually growing despite the treatment. As opposed to, this is another case where we gave Avastin, and the top two are the pre post contrast T1 sequences. The contrast enhancement is completely resolved. So on contrast imaging, it looks as if the response has been wonderful. But on the flare images, you see that the mass effect, the T2, the extent of the lesion has continued to progress. So this is again a pseudo response in relation to Avastin treatment. So this is the flip side of the pseudo response. This is pseudo progression. What we were talking about, the radiation change. So initial study showed a post resection cavity with faint enhancement. And if you compare the pre and post contrast T1 sequences, then those might all be blood byproducts and not be any real enhancement. So that is when you want to see whether there's true enhancement or not. You compare the pre and post contrast. The blood will be looking inherently T1 bright. And then you come see on the post contrast if there is anything in addition to that T1 hyper intensity, that is the real enhancement, and that is what we have to worry about. And then at 1 month apart, it looked as if it had grown, the enhancement is worse, there is a little bit more mass effect, but over a period this remained cold on cerebral blood volume. So on perfusion it was negative, we continued to follow up it, and over a 6 month period it involuted completely. So pseudo progression is actually a good response to treatment. It is actually the outcome certain considered to be better if the patient has pseudo progression, because that is the body immune system reacting and it is suppressing the tumor. So that is actually good. So this is what we like. The My main second chapter was covering the gliomas, because that is by far the most common tumors that you will be encountering in your practice. Our goal should be an outcome, not necessarily that we have to be histologically correct. We don't have to wait for a histological report before we give out our radiology dictation. It has no purpose of being that accurate. Our job is to treat the patient, and if we can serve our purpose, I think we have done a good service to the patients.